If my people call by my name, humble themselves and pray. If they see my face and turn from their sins, I will hear, I will forgive, and I will heal their land. If my people call by my name, humble themselves and pray. If they see my face and turn from their sins, I will hear, I will forgive, and I will heal their land. My eyes shall be my ears will attend to the prayers that are spoken from the hearts of humble men. I have chosen and blessed you that my name may be yours. I've set my heart upon you, and my love will always endure. If my people call by my name, humble themselves and pray. If they see my face and turn from their sins,
good morning and welcome. As we join together on this Canada Day weekend, I pray that you've had a wonderful Canada Day on Friday and that those celebrations have continued over this Canada Day weekend. Today, that's going to be our focus on today's service, is to do our annual Canada Day Sunday service. We're starting a new series today, and we're looking at Noah's days and Noah's ways. And this will take us to probably about middle of August. And we're going to start seeing things about Noah's days and realize we're starting to see some of those same things in our days. Then we're going to look at Noah's ways and realize there's some powerful lessons for us as we are starting to move towards Noah days. So I pray that you'll really enjoy this series. But we want to start off, don't we, with our opening prayer, and then that will lead us into our opening hymns for today. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give our thanks and our praise because we are here and we are yours. And we know, God, that worship is one of the most blessed things we can do. You are smiling and we are smiling. And so on this day, we lift up our spirits and our souls to you. And we just pray that the worship we give you is honoring of you. So God, touch us and bless us in the ways that only you can. We offer our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. So let us begin with our opening music on this Canada Day Sunday.
Thank you.
Let us sing, "We Come to Ask Your Forgiveness." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are just so thankful for this opportunity we have at this moment, and that is to be in your midst, in your presence, to know that we are being touched with holiness, to be touched with your Spirit, to be touched by your love and your grace. Because we know, God, that worship is a time that we truly commune with you, that we feel so in touch with you. Because through the course of a week, sometimes we lose that sense, we lose that touch, especially as we are surrounded with the pressures of the world, the stains of the world. You know what we mean as we see the bloodshed, as we see suffering going on, as we see injustices occur, as we see the unfair situations that happen in our world. It's so easy for us, God, to sometimes just get overwhelmed, sometimes to wonder what's happening. But then we realize that you are there, that you're still in control. And we thank you for that. But we also thank you, God, that you remind us that there's a better way to live than all the injustices, all the things we're seeing going on, and that is by your holy ways. You ask us to live this way. You encourage us. It's the best way for us to live. And sometimes we do this, God, but other times we don't. And for the ways that we've maybe sinned and strayed during this past week, once again, we come to you in this time of prayer and lay our confessions before you. How many times have you heard the same confessions? How many times have you heard us say, "Oh, I'm so sorry"? But each time you say, "My child, thank you. Thank you for being this desire to repent, to be forgiven." So God, thank you once again for giving us your grace, for bestowing your forgiveness upon us, for helping each one of us to walk in that light again. So help us, God, to be children of yours. Help us to be children of the light so that we stand in your light and not sway into the darkness. We offer this prayer in Christ's name, who taught each and every one of us when to pray, to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." But let us enjoy our special music on this day.
Thank you.
Well, we continue on with our memory verses, and today we move to Psalm 121. And for me, this is a psalm I use quite a bit, especially at funerals, because the psalmist starts off with these words, "I look up to the mountains. Does my help come from there?" And isn't that a question? We often ask ourselves, where does my help come from? Where can I look to for help in these moments? And the answer the psalmist gives us is such an important one for us to remember and hold on to. For the psalmist says these words, "My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth." And isn't it interesting that the psalmist just didn't stop at, "My help comes from the Lord." No, "My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth." A reminder to us of God's majestic power, of God's creative ability, of God's might. And isn't that so important for us as we go through situations and wondering, where will our help come from? To look up. Because so often as we're going through struggles and in need of help, where do we look? We look down. We look dejected. We look in despair. We look like we're losing hope. But the psalmist looked up. And as he looked up to the mountains, he realized he needed to look even higher, to the one who created the mountains, his Lord and his God, his creator and his maker. And if we do the same, what a difference it'll make for us in our times of need, in our times where we are in desperate help, because we'll realize God can create a new situation, a better situation for ourselves, that God in his power can help us deal with it, that God can make something new and something better out of it. So, whenever we find ourselves in need of help, may we remember the words from Psalm 121, verses 1 to 2. "I look up to the mountains. Does my help come from there? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." As we remind ourselves of that, we'll be reminded of an awesome God who is always there to help us. May this be a special memory verse. Well, since this is Canada Day weekend, we know one of the things that we as Canadians do at Canada Day is our hearts overflow with our love to be Canadian. And I thought, what a great place to start for our story time today, because that's what I have here, a heart, to remind us how our hearts overflow with the things that we enjoy about being Canadian. So, I brought with me some things that represent us as Canadians. So, here's the first thing, and it is the word A. It's what we're known for, isn't it? It's what everybody around the world thinks of when they think of us as Canadians, that word A. So, first thing I'm going to add to our heart that's overflowing with love for Canada. Now, here's the second thing that's Canadian, a toonie. You know, it's a representative of our money, representative of Canadian money. How so different from, say, European currency or our American courtesy. So, that goes into our heart that's overflowing with our love for Canada. And of course, if we're talking about a toonie, we need to talk about a loonie as well. Again, representative of our love for Canada. But it doesn't stop there, because maybe on Canada Day, you watch the Toronto Blue Jays. And, you know, I just have a Toronto Blue Jays shirt here. It's pretty old, it's pretty raggy, but still, it is representative of us, isn't it? We love our Toronto Blue Jays from coast to coast. Then, of course, how could we not think of Canada and our love for Canada without our Canadian flag, a symbol of us as Canadians? And of course, our heart is overflowing with a love for that as well. But it doesn't stop there, does it? We know that if we talk about our love as Canadians and our hearts overflowing, we need to have something about hockey in there. So, look at this heart. It's almost overflowing, isn't it? But we still need other things that are Canadian, such as maple syrup or Canadian bacon. But how about these two things? I've got a Tim Hortons cup. As we know, Tim Hortons is a proud sign of us as Canadians. And you look, all of a sudden, our heart is overflowing. We are showing our love for Canada wholeheartedly. So, I imagine you've got other things that you might have added to it. Say, for instance, maple syrup, or Niagara Falls, or other things from coast to coast that represents our love wholeheartedly for Canada. Now, as we know, we're not just citizens of Canada as Christians, are we? We're also citizens of the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. Now, let me ask you this. Just as our hearts were wholeheartedly showing a love for us as Canadians, do we do the same as Christians? Because let's think of some of the things that should be filling our hearts, overflowing with our love. For instance, how about the cross and what Jesus did for us on the cross? Shouldn't we have a love for the cross, the hope that it represents, the symbolism that it represents, the love that it shows that Christ died on the cross for our sins? Is our heart overflowing with our love for what Jesus did on the cross? Here's something else that our hearts should be overflowing with, and that is God's Word, God's gift to us. As we know, in here is God's promises, God's truths, God revealing Himself to us. And let me ask you, just as our hearts are overflowing with our love as Canadians, is our heart overflowing with our love for God's Word? How about this? The words that are behind me, faith, hope, and love. Are these in your heart? Is it overflowing in your heart? The faith you have in God, the love you have, the hope you have as you go through those tough and challenging times. On Canada Day, our hearts are overflowing with our pride to be Canadians. But something we should see on a daily basis is that our hearts are overflowing with that same love for God, with all the things that are God. Because if we do this, we'll be walking with more assurance. We'll be walking with a love for the Lord. We'll be walking with the hope we need to keep persevering. So I pray that on this Canada Day weekend, that your heart's been overflowing with your pride and joy to be Canadian. But I pray on this weekend and every day that your heart is overflowing with your pride and joy to be a child of God. That is our story time and pondering time for today. Let us continue our worship now with our next hymn.
Yeah.
Turn to our next series that we're going to be looking at now. Let us come before God, shall we, in our prayer for understanding. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we know that one of the things we need so much in this world is your word. Because every day we hear words that trouble us and disturb us. Words of gunshots, words of violence, words of injustice, words that just hit deep at our core and make us worry and make us fret. But the words we need most are your words, God. The words that remind us that you're in control, that you're a loving God, that you're a caring God, that you are there for us. So God, as we come before your word right now, we just once again ask that you open our hearts and minds and ears so that we can be touched, that we can embrace your words, that we can come away empowered in ways that touches us and inspires us. We offer this prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Well, you recall over the last month, we've been looking at the series of What's Next? And we looked at so many things, didn't we? What's next until we await Jesus' return? What's next if we die before Jesus returns? What's next when Jesus does return and Judgment Day happens? And last week, if you tuned in, we looked at what's next, the new heaven and new earth. Well, today, we're starting a new series that'll take us probably into the middle of August, and it's called Noah Days and Noah Ways. So we're going to look at the story of Noah, to look at his days, and to see ways that he was able to cope and persevere, to take those lessons away for our ways as well. So today, we're starting off in Genesis 6, verses 5 to 9, and looking at the days that Noah was living in, and what God was seeing, and what Noah had to endure. So let's start at verse 5. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. The Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. So the Lord said, I will wipe from the face of the earth of the human race I have created, and with them the animals, the birds, and the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. This is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, I want you to imagine for a moment, based on what we have just heard, taking things in from God's perspective. Imagine if you're in heaven with God and looking down upon the days and times of Noah to see that so many people are doing things that are evil and goes against the ways of the Lord. And not just a few people know. And not just a slight majority, like 50% plus one. No, nor do you see just 75% or 90% of the people doing things that are totally and consistently evil in God's eyes. No, you are seeing what God is seeing. Everyone except one family, doing all these negative, all these nasty, all these evil things. But you see one family that's doing right in God's eyes. So you're basically seeing 99.9% of the population doing things that are evil. Now, you're not just seeing them do things some of the times that are evil, or certain things that are evil. No. Scripture tells us that you are seeing that they are doing this consistently, that everything they think, everything they imagine is totally and consistently evil. Now, we're not told what these things were, but obviously, As you're sitting there beside God and looking down upon all this, you realize that these people are doing everything that goes against what God says and wants. Now, you've imagined Noah's days from God's perspective. Now here, I want you to do something different. I want you to now imagine what life was like for Noah in those days and times. To be the only family that was living according to God's ways. Can you imagine how alone you would feel? That you're living by a different set of rules, a different set of ideals and standards than anyone else? Or can you imagine how you couldn't trust anyone? Because you see, the people were not only just doing things that were evil, they were acting in ungodly ways. There was no integrity going on. Can you imagine living in a society and at times where you couldn't trust a single person outside of your family? And then, imagine your worry about your own safety. As we know, that's one of our needs, that's one of our worries. And remember what people were doing back then. Everything they imagined, everything they said, everything they did was consistently and totally evil. Imagine the pressure that Noah was under to compromise, to give up on his faith, to live according to their ideals instead of to God's ideals. That gives us some insight, some understanding, what it was like for what God was seeing and what Noah was having to live in his days and times. Now, how did it get to that point? Because here we are, just in Genesis chapter 6. It wasn't that long ago that we were in the Garden of Eden. Genesis chapter 2, in the early parts of Genesis 3, we're in the Garden of Eden with no sin. But isn't that where it began? Isn't where this journey began towards Noah's days when Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden? That is the first act of disobedience. And as we see, it ended up to a time in Noah's days where everyone was committing acts of disobedience. But then in Genesis 4, we see the first committed act of evil and violence when Cain killed his brother Abel. There again, we're seeing just in Genesis 4, the first act of violence. And then by the time we get to Genesis 6, everyone is thinking of things and imagining things that is consistently and totally evil and violent. How did we get to this point? Well, it was a slow progression. It didn't happen overnight, no. Because when you read the genealogy between Adam and Noah, people lived very long times back in those days. For instance, Adam lived to the age of 930. There were other people who lived almost just as long. There were other people in the genealogy in the family tree that we see lived to 800 years old. And as we know, Noah was of a ripe old age when we read this story today. People lived a very long time back in those days and times. And it was just basically a very slow, a very steady progression over time that led to this period where everything people said and did was totally and consistently evil. Interesting, isn't it? And as I thought about that, considered about this didn't happen overnight. It was a slow, steady, progressive change. It made me ask this question. Are we on that same trajectory? Are we going in that same direction? A very slow, steady change towards becoming more like Noah's days. Now, I'll be honest, we're not there yet. No, thankfully, we're not there yet. Could you imagine? But still, are we going in that direction? Well, the best way to kind of understand and wonder, are we going in that direction, is to kind of compare what life was like for many of us, say, back 20 years ago, or 30 or 40 or 50 years ago. Because I imagine many of you are as old or even older than me. You know, I'm 57, turning 58 this month. You can imagine we've had a lot of things. We've seen a lot of changes over the years. For instance, do you remember how much safer society used to be? Do you remember where you didn't have to worry about locking your car doors at night? You know, if you forgot to do so, you didn't have to worry you'd go out the next day and somebody had broken into your car. Oh, sure, it could happen, but not as regularly as it does today. Or, do you remember, you didn't have to lock your door when you went out in the day, no. You go off to work, you leave your doors unlocked. You didn't have to worry about somebody breaking in. It could happen. But you had neighbors who were watching. You had neighbors who knew if there was a stranger in your neighborhood. Or, do you remember when you could let your children just go out and play? And sometimes you wouldn't see them for hours and hours. They could be over at the park. They could be down at a neighbor's house. But did you worry? Did you fret? Sure, there was incidences of child abductions, but not the same as you see today. And then, the acts of violence. Looking back over the years, was it as violent a society as you see happening today? Maybe there was the odd gunshot. Maybe there was the odd fight. But did you always open your paper and see the amounts of acts of violence as you see happening in today's days and times, where you hear there was this shootout at a nightclub in Toronto, or bullets flying in Hamilton, or it's hearing about this fight or this altercation or this brouhaha that was happening. As we see, things are changing, aren't they? Things that we saw maybe back in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, they're kind of intensifying now, aren't they? It's not as safe a society. We're seeing more violence. We're seeing more anger. We're seeing more people being taken advantage of. We're seeing less type of integrity happening in these days and times. It would appear that we're slowly, slowly moving in that trajectory, aren't we? Quickly changing, where things are getting worse than better. Things are becoming more violent. More and more people are thinking in terms of evil than in terms of good and blessings. It seems like we're on that same trajectory. But here's the thing. There's many reasons people give. Why do we see these type of changes take place and happen in societies? You know, some will say that maybe the justice system is overwhelmed. Others will say that maybe it's because we need more policing. Or maybe we need more programs to provide a better social network so people can get the help that they need. And these are all very good suggestions. But when you look at the changes that were happening back in Noah's days and some of the changes that are happening in our days, doesn't it get down to values? Values like honesty and integrity. Values like respect for other people's property. Values like honoring other people, showing love for other people, instead of having greed, a lust for money, a lust for power, and so on and so on. As you can see, many of these changes have to do with values, not changes to the social systems and justice systems. But there was another change back in Noah's days that was causing this steady and slow progression to the point it got, that everybody was doing things consistently evil, and it was this. People were turning their backs on God. People were no longer wanting a relationship with God. And where we see this in our passage is in these words from Genesis 6:6. So the Lord was sorry he had ever made them and put them on earth. It broke the heart. Now, some would say, and some have made the suggestion, that God was admitting he was making a mistake here. No, that's not the right interpretation of this verse or God saying here. God is perfect. He doesn't make mistakes. What God was acknowledging here is this, that he was grieving the fact that people had freely chosen to reject him, to turn his back on him, and choose to do evil things. Choose death, choose sin, instead of choosing to live a righteous life. And as I saw this, I began to wonder, as we were looking earlier, that maybe we're on that same steady progression that Noah's generation was in. Have people today done this very same thing? Are we seeing more and more people turn their backs on God, desire to not have a relationship with him? Well, how do we answer this? Again, we have to look back, don't we? And see, has this changed in our society? Have we seen this change unfolding? And I think we know the answer, don't we? Because for many of us, we can remember what church was like, say back in the 50s or 60s or 70s and even the 80s, when churches were filled. That you could see people in church on Sunday, where the church was the center and focus of maybe a community, where it was something that people valued, people looked forward to, people had a faith. But something we have seen so much in churches, isn't it? We're starting to see missing generations. We're starting to see more and more people decide they don't want to raise their families in a church. They don't want to have a faith and relationship with God at this time. And I'm not saying they're bad people, no. They're just choosing not to have a relationship with God at this point. And I was reminded of this after I did a funeral recently. I was at the cemetery, and one of the prayers I did was the Lord's Prayer. And usually I get a lot of people join in on the Lord's Prayer, but on this particular one, it was almost silent, but just a few people who joined in. Well, as I was leaving the cemetery and walking to my car, there was a young man with his son that was walking behind me. And I overheard him saying, "Do you remember how the minister was praying that prayer? And how Daddy was joining in saying the same words?" And he was referring to the Lord's Prayer. And he said, and he admitted, "You know, we're not religious. We're not raising you in the church. But if you ever wondered why I was saying, why I knew those words, it's because I learned it when I was younger." But as you can see, many people are making that intentional decision to not have a close relationship with God. And the more and more that happens, are we going to see this trend begin to happen even more like Noah's days? People not knowing God. People not knowing God's ways. People turning their back on God, and so on and so on. As you can see, we're not quite in Noah's days yet, and thankfully, we're not. Can you even imagine? But we're moving in that direction. But Noah, even though we've imagined what life was like for him, we know what he did. He chose differently. And we see that in what God said in Genesis 6:8. But Noah found favor with God. So how did he do that? How was he able to find favor with God and live in those ways, even though he was living in a time when people did everything that was consistently evil? Well, it gets to this. Noah was wholehearted when it came to three things in his life. And it gets back to my story time, doesn't it? Wholehearted. So, what was Noah so wholehearted about in his days and his ways? Well, the first thing that he was wholehearted in was in his walk with the Lord. And in particular, he was wholehearted committed to staying in close fellowship with the Lord. And you notice, in close fellowship. He just didn't do this sometimes, nor was he inconsistent on it. Because you can imagine if he was inconsistent, one toe in, one toe out. Or sometimes he was in close fellowship, other times he wouldn't. Wouldn't he fall more and more into the ways of the world in those times? But no. He was wholehearted. He was fully committed to staying close to the Lord. And if we want to stay connected with God and His ways, isn't it so important that we do the same as Noah? Commit to being wholehearted and staying in close fellowship with God. That's the first thing that Noah did in his ways. The second thing that shows what Noah was doing in his ways in those days is that he chose righteous living. Because in Genesis 6:9, that is what is described in Noah's life. He lived a righteous life. Now, what does righteousness mean? It means obeying the laws and teachings and commands of God. And we know those are reflected in the Ten Commandments, aren't they? Now, many of you might be saying, "But Dean, Noah didn't have the Ten Commandments in those days, no. But he would have heard the stories about the Garden of Eden. He would have known that God had certain things he wanted us to obey. That God had commands and teachings. And there's a connection between obedience and blessings and disobedience and punishment. He would have known that. And because he walked in close fellowship with God, don't you think God revealed his righteous ways of living to him? And what was Noah wholeheartedly committed to? Not just knowing them, but obeying them as well. And if we want to live in the same way as Noah in our days, then we need to be just as wholeheartedly committed to righteous living. So, the first of Noah's ways in his days was he was wholehearted in walking in close fellowship with the Lord. Secondly, he was wholehearted when it came to choosing righteous living. And the final thing that Noah was wholehearted about was this: to live a blameless life before God. Now, what does it mean to live a blameless life before God? It doesn't mean you live a perfect life. No, because as we know, as much as we could strive to a righteous living, we're not always going to be perfect. No, what blameless means in biblical terms is this: a life of integrity, a life of honesty. And some would say, well, isn't that the same as righteousness? No, there is differences, isn't it? But I think there is a connection. That if we are going to choose to be wholehearted in choosing God's righteous ways, doesn't it just kind of flow? That we're also going to be wholehearted in also living a life of blameless, living a life of integrity? For instance, if we're going to live a life of righteousness, are we going to lie to others and lose our integrity? Are we going to cheat others and lose our integrity? Are we going to make our yes all of a sudden a no and make people question, were we really sincere? No. We are going to live a blameless life. We're going to make sure our yes is a yes and our no is a no. Why? Because righteous living helps to encourage blameless living, a life of integrity as well. So there you have it. That's how Noah lived in those days and times before the flood. And as a result, he was the only one who found favor with God. And obviously, God was watching over him. God was protecting him in a time where everything people said and did was consistently evil. We've learned today that as much as we wish we weren't, I think we are going in that same progression, aren't we? That same type of direction as Noah's society did, slowly progressing to seeing things more evil, more corrupt, more violent than what we ever have seen before. And I think one of the things the pandemic has done is hasten the pace. Because aren't we seeing people angrier, more upset, more acts of violence happening than, say, we did even 2 years ago? We're on that course of direction. But let's make sure, even though we're starting to see some of Noah's days in our ways, let's make sure we follow his ways. How? By first choosing to be wholeheartedly stay in close fellowship with him. Second, to make sure we're wholehearted in choosing righteous living over unrighteous living. And third, to make sure that because we're choosing righteous living, we are wholehearted in living a life of integrity, living a blameless life in God's sight. Because if we do these things, no matter how bad our days become, God will be looking down upon us and say the same as he said about Noah: this is a child of mine who I find favorable. Isn't that a better way to live in these days and times? Let us learn. Let us follow in Noah's example. God bless and amen. Well, let us come before God, shall we, in our prayers of the people on this Canada Day weekend. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this worship time. It is always so uplifting. It is always so encouraging You are there for us, God. You bless us. You touch us in the most amazing ways. And we thank you as we've started this new series on Noah's days and Noah's ways for reminding us that even though we're starting to move in that same direction as Noah's days, that we're not there yet. And oh, are we so glad. But we also realize that there are ways about how people are living today that we need to make sure it doesn't affect our walk with you. So help us to be as intentional as Noah was and wholehearted in our walk with you so that we stay in close fellowship, that we choose righteous living, and that we choose integrity to live a blameless life in your sight. I know it's a high calling, but isn't it a better calling? And we thank you for showing that to us, God. We thank you as well for this country of Canada in which we live. We're so proud to call ourselves Canadians. We're so blessed to be in this great country of ours. Help us to never take this gift that you've given us for granted. We know, God, that these are challenging times for us in Canada as it is for people throughout this world. But may we pray that faith is sustained in this great country of ours, that our leaders remember that they can't get through without you, that they seek your guidance and they seek your wisdom. We pray that your values will continue to guide our nation. And we know, God, that we are just so thankful and that we are also part of a greater nation, the kingdom of heaven. So we pray over our leaders, we pray over our nation as we go through the struggles and times, and we just pray that you will guide our leaders to solve the many problems that are happening in these days. We continue our prayers for those going through health issues and ask God that you touch them and give them the healing they need at this time. We pray for the grieving. We know many have lost loved ones and are just hurting deep down inside. And we just pray, God, that you lift their spirits and their souls. We pray for the many who are going through challenges right now, trying to make ends meet. May they not give up. May they never stop hoping. May they realize, God, they can turn to you for help, that you know our needs and you will provide. We pray as well for our teachers and our students who have come to the end of another school year. And we just pray over them, God, that they'll get the rest and the joy and the relaxation they need. We pray for those who are at their cottages for the summer. It's a time of rest, a time of relaxation. And we just pray over them, God, that they will enjoy their times away. We know many will be traveling in the summer season. Be with them, God. Help them to have safe journeys. And may we just pray that this time of summer will be a time we can see family and friends, we can enjoy this beautiful season, and we can enjoy our beautiful God. We offer our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Well, let us join now in singing our closing hymn for this day.
Promises.
thank you for joining us for our worship today. I hope you've enjoyed the start to our online worship in this new series, Noah Ways and Noah Days. And we're going to continue next week, and I hope you'll join us for that. I continue to just encourage you, if you know of people who can be blessed by our ministry here at Mount Pleasant, that you just share our link, that you just encourage them to tune in, because that's what our hope is, that's what our desire is. If you haven't been already doing so, I also write a midweek message, and you can just go on our website at Mount Pleasant Presbyterian Church, and you can just click on the links that would lead you to our midweek messages, or if you want to receive them by email, just send us a quick email hit, and we'll be glad to send them to you. We've also got our new Today devotional books out at the church. So if you would like the devotional for the month of July and August, please just let me know and we'll find a way to get them to you. So I pray that you have a blessed week, an enjoyable week. I pray that you'll stay closely connected to God through this week. We'll have the benediction and then we'll close with our closing benediction pieces. So now, the benediction. May the road rise up to greet thee. May the wind always be at your back. May the sun shine warmly upon thy face, and the rain fall softly upon thy fields. And until we meet again, may God hold each one of us safely in the palm of his hand. God bless and amen, and have the most blessed of week. See you next time.